Hello everyone, we're getting ready to look up today with a brand new Uplook video, counting down a top 10 list. You can like the video, subscribe, and make sure to ring the bell so you don't miss any of our future videos. Today, we'll think about 10 steps to reboot your hope. We're told in Romans 5 that tribulation produces perseverance, and perseverance character, and character hope. But even in tough times, hope doesn't disappoint. Why? Because as our hope struggles through the troubles, the Spirit is pouring God's love in. So writes Paul. Want to be one of the most hopeful people around? Here are 10 ways to rebuild that hope. We're going to start off our list with number one, understand what biblical hope is.
Yeah, the definition itself can really help us because we sometimes assume that hope is the way we use it in the vernacular, like I hope it doesn't rain, where there's an element of doubt, but that's not the way the hope is. It's a certain hope in the Word of God. And we might define it as the present enjoyment of future certainties. So God has promised us certain things in His Word, and we lay hold of these. Now there's a verse that says, hope deferred makes the heart sick. And sometimes when we get our eyes off the hope and onto circumstances like Peter, we start to sink because we've lost our focus on Christ, who is our hope.
And number two, check out the adjectives the Bible uses to describe our hope.
They're beautiful, really. Romans 8:24, it's called a saving hope. In Romans 12:12, it's a joyful hope. In chapter 15, verse 13, it's an abounding hope. In Ephesians 4:4, it's a shared hope. In Colossians 1:27, it's a glorious hope. And in 1 Thessalonians 1:3, it's a patient hope. In 2 Thessalonians 2:16, it's a good hope. Titus 2:13, it's a blessed hope. Amazing, isn't it? Hebrews 6:11, it's a sure hope. In 1 Peter 1:3, it's a living hope. In 3:15, it's a reasonable hope. It's a wonderful thing to realize that this hope is a purifying hope. He that has this hope in him purifies himself even as he is pure. So when I keep our focus on the future, a lot of the things around me just diminish in their importance, and I can lay hold of the hope that is set before us. They're all wrapped up in this one phrase in 1 Timothy 1:1, the Lord Jesus Christ, our hope. So our hope is based in a person, and when we have that person who's the unchangeable Christ, our hope ought to be in pretty good health.
And going along with finding out how the Bible describes this hope, number three, make a little notebook of the promises of hope.
Yeah, when we're going through dark times, difficult times, it's great to have a little handy do-it-yourself encouragement kit and look in this little book of promises, because verses like Isaiah 40, verse 31, or Romans 5, 5, Psalm 119, 114, Micah 7, 7, 1 Peter 1, 3, these are just a few, and many of those that I've already referred to, that could go into that little booklet. And if you tend to have a melancholy personality and difficulties give you a bit of a dark spirit, well, you can open up. It's just like looking into heaven to see these glorious promises regarding our hope. And I think that really boosts our hearts.
And number four, have a straight talk with your own soul the way David did.
I like that about David. He says in Psalm 42:11, why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you upset within me? Hope in God. And then notice, for I will yet praise him. What he's saying is, the circumstances around me, I have no idea what's going on. I don't see any good coming out of them. I'm not sure I can praise him for them right now, but he has such a good track record of turning bad things into good things, turning curses into blessings, straightening out the mess, and all of a sudden it's like, wow, how did he do that? I will yet praise him, he says. I'm not sure I can do it right now, but I will yet praise him, the one who is the health of my countenance. Isn't that beautiful? The person who has a happy countenance probably has a good recognition of God's hopefulness, God's spirit of fixing things, of straightening things out, of bringing the best out of circumstances. So he says, I can't really do it right now, but buck up, O soul, pay attention. Notice how God has this wonderful record of fixing things. So hope in God, because he's pulled it off before. He's going to pull it off again.
And number five, notice that every believer has the same one hope from Ephesians 4:4.
Right. There are seven things in that chapter that describe wonderful blessings that every believer shares. If you sit down with someone in a factory or an office and you find out they're a believer, they may have differences, but these seven things are true of every believer. Now, obviously, it's not the timing of the hope, because you got pre-trib and post-trib and amill and partial rupture. You got all kinds of views about when it's going to happen. That's not really the hope. The hope is that it will happen and what will happen. We will be with Christ and like Christ, and that's the hope of every believer. And because of that, we can share that hope with one another, and this will encourage us, because in the Christian life, you only get it when you give it away. And maybe the reason our hope has grown dim is we're not talking about it. When I was a kid, everybody was talking about the Lord's coming. People didn't preach the word unless they mentioned the Lord was coming back. But today, that's sort of waned, and people rarely talk about the Lord's coming. It's a controversial issue, so don't talk about it. It's not controversial that the Lord's coming back. It's not controversial that he's going to catch us up, and it's not controversial that we're going to be like him. So let's share the hope. And when we give it away, like a boomerang, it comes back to us.
And that moves right into number six. Remember that our hope is enriched by inviting others to join us.
Right. The Apostle Paul says this, and it's a beautiful statement. What is our hope or joy or crown of rejoicing? Is it not even you in the presence of our Lord Jesus at his coming? I'm reminded of Samuel Rutherford, who wrote these beautiful letters while he was in prison for his faith. And Ann Ross' cousin took those and wrote the beautiful poem, Emmanuel's Land. And one of the stanzas talks about the little town of Anwath in Scotland, where Rutherford lived. And she has him saying from his correspondence, oh, if one soul from Anwath meets me at God's right hand, my heaven will be two heavens in Emmanuel's land. So one of the things that makes heaven richer is the thought that people we meet every day, we can invite them to come to heaven with us and enjoy heaven's hospitality forever. And if they respond, this makes heaven all the richer because we're heading there together.
So sharing our hope with believers, but then also sharing it with unbelievers so that they can participate in that hope.
Exactly, because the scripture says they have no hope. They're without God and without hope. And so we've got the hope to share with them.
And number seven, it's biblical to pray for our inner eyes to be open to see our hope clearly.
Right, if your hope is waning, ask the Lord. Listen to these verses in Ephesians chapter 1. Paul writes that he doesn't cease to pray for them, quote, in verse 17, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope. So Paul says, I'm praying for you that the Spirit of God will give you this spiritual insight to see the hope and to live in the good of that hope. So if you're struggling with hope, ask the Lord to open those inner eyes to see the hope you have.
And number eight, maybe the world's bright lights have robbed us of our ability to see heaven.
You know what it's like in a bright city. You look up, you can hardly see the stars. And because we're so distracted by so much stuff around us, the phrase heaven can wait, things get so good down here, we forget that we've got heaven ahead of us. And this world always disappoints us. The Lord doesn't disappoint us. So we need to get our eyes off the stuff and back on the Lord. And so the patriarchs are a great example of this, even though we sometimes think, well, they're Old Testament and they had an earthly inheritance. When we read about the patriarchs, they had the same hope we have. We read that Abram, quote, dwelt in the land of promise as in a foreign country, living in tents with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise, for he waited for the city that has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Abraham was loaded. He probably had 1,000 servants. He was very wealthy. Lots of other people were living in cities, living in nice houses. He purposefully drove in his tent pegs everywhere he went and lived in a tent all those years because he was saying something. This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. And he wanted everybody else to say, what's with Abraham? And to come and ask him a reason for the hope. If we've got the same hope the world has, I want the Dow Jones Industrial to return to its high numbers. If that's my hope, then nobody's going to ask me about it. But when I'm content to let the world go by, and I have a bright hope, they're going to ask me, what's going on? What makes you so happy in a world like this? And I can tell them what it is.
And number 9, in the Christian life, we get things by giving them away.
Have you shared your hope lately? In Romans 15:13, we read, now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. So the idea of abounding is overflowing. God gives us so much it sloshes over. We can't keep it to ourselves. And you know, when my heart is full of hope, I just have to talk about it. I just can't shut my mouth. Like the story of Hannah, she says, the Lord's made me a big mouth. He's enlarged my mouth, and I just can't stop talking about him. So when we fix our eyes on the hope, it's not too long until out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks, and people are encouraged too.
And finally, number 10, in the end, our hope isn't a theory or a doctrine. What is it actually?
Right. I mean, obviously, there are doctrinal aspects to our hope. We're not saying that there aren't. But at the heart of it all, it's a person, right? Christ in you, the hope of glory. So the idea is that by the Spirit, the Holy Spirit is Christ's representative, and he's moved in until something happens, until he gets us home. So the Lord said, I'm standing at the door knocking. I want to come in, sup with you, you with me. So I'm going to move into you until I've got your place ready in heaven, and then I'm going to invite you home to be with me. So as we think about the person who is our hope, he's thoroughly dependable. He's kept all his promises up to now. We can count on him. And when we realize he's moved in and he's not leaving until the job is done, then our hope quickens, our hope comes alive when we realize that our hope is not in ideas or theories or arguments about this view of prophecy or that. Our hope is in a person, and this person is going to pull off what he said he'd do.